God of War Ragnarok is the long-awaited sequel to the 2018 God of War, which reinvented Kratos as a sort of sad dad man. And Ragnarok is another kind of reinvention again that widens the scope of this new kind of Norse mythology-based chapter of God of War.
Yeah, I think of it a bit like it's almost like an expensive luxury car.
Yeah,
that you start in first gear and you're like, yeah, this is a car. I know what this is. But then you just sort of smoothly go up through the gears, and then with Ragnarok specifically, once you sort of get to the latter stages of the game, it's like my car doesn't even have this many gears. It just keeps going. It just keeps going. And as you reach the climax, it is a really big deal. It's really good.
And just to touch very lightly on the ending, we're not going to spoil things too much, but Corey Barlog said that this was the end of the Norse saga. Is there a hint of what comes after? Because if not, if we're done with the Norse saga, then what's next? Like, does he end up in like India? Is it going to be like the pantheon of like Hindu gods or something that he butts heads with next?
No, I can give you the scoop here, Jim. It is it's a shot for shot remake of the end of Quantum Leap.
Right. Okay. Brilliant. So one thing that we discussed when you started playing the game a couple of weeks back. And I find this really interesting, was that, so we see Odin and Thor in Ragnarok and a wider cast of characters come into play. Of course, we saw Baldur in the first Chris Judge God of War game.
Yeah.
And now we bring in kind of the rest of the kind of the pantheon of Norse gods.
Yeah.
And the portrayal here is much different from what a lot of people are used to, because of course we've had Assassin's Creed. We've had, probably the biggest kind of popularization factor for Norse mythology in the past couple of decades is the Marvel, MCU,
exactly.
Right? So everyone's expecting Thor to be gorgeous, frankly, and really cool, but he's not. He's a bit of a knobhead. But the thing I found really interesting that you said, you likened their portrayal of Odin as sort of like a mob boss, like a Vito Corleone figure, which I find fascinating, and it really fits.
Yeah, I said in my review on vg247.com, check it out, the characterization of the villains in God of War Ragnarok and the supporting cast in general is almost as revolutionary as the reinvention of Kratos' character in the 2018 game.
Yeah.
The focus is widened and shifted so much that these characters get so much more screen time, they're so much more developed, that it, as you say, it is a really interesting study in characterizing these figures that you've maybe heard of but don't know so much about. What really stuck out to me was you mentioned like Marvel films and Assassin's Creed and stuff like that. You get all of these different mythologized representations of different cultures, and they're always a kind of happy-go-lucky, or you're playing as the gods themselves, and so they're the protagonist, they're the hero in these stories, whatever. But if you dig into the actual stories, particularly with Greek myths and stuff, you see like the father character in Disney's Hercules seems to do a lot of impregnating people and sending them to have their liver eaten out by a bird of prey for eternity. They're not nice people, and they don't have. And literally with the story of Prometheus or whatever, where Zeus sentences him to have his liver eaten out every day or whatever, that was for giving fire to people, right? So they don't have the interests of regular people at heart.
No.
And the mob boss characterization fits so well because it's an understated menace, it's a conniving, and the only thing that Odin really cares about is averting this prophesied fate that he's seen of Ragnarok.
Yeah.
And if you're unfamiliar, Ragnarok is the Norse mythology's end of the world scenario, and where there's a cataclysmic war and the end of the pantheon of gods is prophesied.
Yeah.
And so as king of the gods, as Allfather, Odin doesn't want this to happen because he's at the top of the tree and he wants to stay there, essentially.
Yeah.
And as an interloper in this story, Kratos has come from Greek mythology and is just trying to find a quiet life for himself. But that lack of control that Odin has over this unforeseen actor in the story is what drives a lot of the plot. And
yeah,
the contrivances and kind of conniving nature of Odin's plans to get one over or control Kratos is what drives a lot of the interest and intrigue in the story. And it is, and the way that some of the story elements of Norse mythology that you might be familiar with, how they're kind of bent around the characters and pan out in God of War Ragnarok is really fun. It's really interesting. You think, they've skated around this bit isn't going to happen. Because there are a lot of key pillars that even people that aren't super up on the story will remember certain characters, certain beasts, certain creatures that have a key role in it. It all comes back in ways that are exciting, interesting, that you don't expect. And yeah, it's just really good.
I like that, the comparing Odin in this to Vito Corleone in The Godfather. And it's like Ragnarok is the sort of the drugs trade that he's trying to resist. probably not going to go too much further in that simile because that's just Steve Burns chat. I love that as well. We're talking about Chris Judge. His portrayal as, you could argue, a more kind of mature, a more kind of affected Kratos than his original kind of incarnation as just sort of an angry, bald man proxy for the player to mash buttons into. And now he's this entire kind of like, he's a guy, he's got a son, he's got regrets. Chris Judge plays this character beautifully. And I think he is a very interesting choice and quite annoying one on behalf of the studio, because, like, of course, you're talking about stories that depict the gods as cruel rather than as heroic.
Yeah.
Of course, like, one of the biggest examples of that is Stargate, right? Like, you know, these aliens are essentially either posing as those gods or are the genesis of those ancient gods, and they are cruel, and they are very indifferent to the success of the human race they're supposed to be shepherding, and literally just are tyrants.
Yeah, I had a bit of a look at Stargate because I was interested in Christopher Judge, and it's interesting that you say that because I've not watched it. I think it came out like 20 years ago, so it is a little bit of a Hello Fellow Kids reference if I'm going to stick the boot in. While I was having a look at stuff he'd done before, I think he did actually write a few of the episodes.
He wrote
and directed them. So he definitely has a good insight and, yeah, like you say, a knowing air that he can bring to the character. I think it does a little bit of a disservice to the backstory of Kratos to say that he was an absolute complete reinvention. Is slightly exaggerated. It reminds me a bit of the James Bond films where so between Sean Connery and Roger Moore, there's George Lazenby, and in that film, Bond's wife dies at the end or whatever.
Yeah.
And they make reference to that quite a lot in the Roger Moore films, that he sort of has this sort of stoic, that a character will roll there, will kind of, to show their power of a Bond, they'll sort of recite his backstory and be like, married just once, didn't end well or whatever. And he'll sort of get really sort of stiff about it and annoyed. And that's probably one of the best bits about Roger Moore's portrayal. But it's very similar to God of War. In the Grecian portion of the God of War series, it's not like it was Tekken or something that he was just beating up.
Yeah, blood. You're right. You are right.
There was a lot of drama. He had another family that he was forced to kill or tricked into killing by Zeus or by Ares. Sorry. And that was the impetus for him becoming the God of War in the first place. Mm-hmm. So it's the regrets that he has contrivances. They're not just kind of made up out of nowhere. It's drawing on the mythos of the character of Kratos as much as the mythology and the culture of the Norse gods as well. Yeah. And I think that the how it reinvents itself is drawing the focus more tightly into the characters themselves rather than the kind of macro plot, that it's the micro plot of the internal thoughts and drives of the characters and the interpersonal relationships between how they interact with each other. And the way that Ragnarok reinvents that again is by widening the cast of characters to include this sort of renewed focus on the villains as well. And so that's how you get the more understated, menacing, conniving portrayal of Odin. That's how you get... I don't want to talk about too much about Thor and his arc, because that's a really big part of Ragnarok and is an interesting one that I wouldn't want to spoil for anybody. But there are returning characters as well. There's a lot more depth to Brock and Sindri, the dwarven brothers that help you out for the duration of the game. There's a lot more Freya's character, so Odin's wife, called Frigg in the Aesir, but she's a Vanir god that's from Vanaheim, which is one of the nine realms of Norse mythology. And she was essentially forced into marrying Odin and she's Baldur's mother. And so there's the fallout of that game, and Shovzi isn't very happy with Kratos and Atreus for killing Baldur, and she has a really interesting arc as well. And so, that's why I say that it's almost as revolutionary as the reinvention of Kratos, that it manages to take the zoomed in focus and zoom it out again, but just a little bit, or not so much zoom it out as turn the camera zoomed into different places, and that's what makes it so interesting.
There's a lot going on. There's a lot of spinning plates happening. And of course, it is a really big game. How long did it take you to finish?
It took me roughly 40 hours to do the main story and about 75 to 80% of the side content.
Okay.
So how it works is you'll have like a main story beat in one of the nine realms.
Yeah.
And at the end, it'll kind of go, do you fancy going to an exploration area and doing some side quests and stuff? And you can either break off and go into a big new area and find all different chests and upgrade your stuff and find armor and stuff. Or you can go back to the hub area and continue the story and go somewhere different and all that sort of stuff.
So it's one of these really spectacular kind of single player Sony third person adventures that they are. I mean, they've now got down to a fine art. And I think... I saw an article recently. I don't want to get too bogged down into it, but it was quite a scathing article about the 2018 God of War, about how God of War in all of its incarnations is basically video games, the video game, and it will reflect sort of any of the kind of current trends, any of the kind of modern expectation of a AAA game will be reflected in whatever the latest God of War of the time is, which was, and in this piece, it was kind of put together as if that was like a really bad thing. But actually, I think I love the artistry of God of War, and I don't think it's ever been better than the Norse saga. It's artistically it's really beautifully put together, but it is also very similar in pacing mechanically to things like Uncharted 4 or even The Last of Us, right? And I just wanted to put this to you, because I personally don't think that's a bad thing. You can call it formulaic. Every one of these games has like fighting and climbing and opening chests and all this and a bit of crafting and a bit of like and all of these common elements just kind of endlessly remixed into slightly different things. But I kind of feel like it's less that these games aren't inventive, and it's more that like, well, we've cracked how to make them good. So now we can focus on things like characterization and beautiful artistry, which isn't just about being photorealistic. It's more about art serving the story and things like that. What do you think about that, basically, is what I'm getting at.
For all of the amazing character work that there is in God of War Ragnarok, it does a lot of great work to establish subtext and insinuate some interesting and beautiful things, like you say.
Yeah.
But at some points, particularly in the side quests, it has a bit of a bad habit of just being like, of just saying the quiet part loud. To make another Hello Fellow Children reference, it reminds me a little bit of the opera episode of Futurama, where the robot devil's like, you can't just have your characters say how they feel. That makes me feel angry. That happens quite a lot in, particularly at the end of the main side quests in each exploration area. That it'll put a lot of really interesting work into establishing, like, with a lot of the side quests, Kratos only does it because he's interested in spending time with his son, because that's what he wants to do. And then at the end, a character just kind of says, he only does it to spend time with your lad, or whatever. And it's like, yeah, I know. I knew that bit. You didn't have to say that. So, it's interesting that other people have picked up on that as well, that it is not necessarily a groundbreaking experience in every way. And I think it's interesting to say that it's a representation of trends in general, because I think that these big Sony first party exclusives have kind of established their own trend in themselves.
Yes.
Yeah. That they've taken almost more inspiration from HBO dramas to take it back around to the gangster things in The Sopranos again, that it's like Sony first party almost takes more inspiration from the so-called golden age of television or whatever, that it is these zoomed in character focused experiences. And then, like you say, it's the distillation of really high budget, really talented action adventure work on the other side of it to make them as playable in a kind of transient age of Fortnite, of Genshin Impact, of things that work in seasons, that are trying to have your attention for years at a time rather than a weekend or whatever.
Yeah.
The way that they've combated this is by just making them so huge, so dense, so worthy of investment and so character driven, with the RPG elements on it that, I don't want to say pad out, because it's not padded out, because it is all part of it. It is all intrinsic to your progress. And that, I think that's the problem that they're trying to solve. And that's the impetus behind why these games are like that, because they're trying to compete for your interest in a kind of market that wants to monopolize every second of what you're doing with your free time.
And everything is absolutely screaming for your attention all the time.
Yeah.
Like, even something as fucking simple and basic and as Marvel Snap, where every game of it is engineered to take up no more than 3 minutes of your time.
Yeah.
But yet the thing is constantly screaming at me about fucking, you gotta work hard to get Miles Morales, you know.
Yeah.
And it's like, I don't have the fucking time. Like, I play this on the toilet. Like, leave me alone. I think we are at this point now where we have slowly been witnessing the convergence of Uncharted and Skyrim. And if you said that to somebody like 10 years ago, the prospect sounds absolutely ludicrous. And yet, that's where we are. I mean, what is God of War Ragnarok if not the essentially that midpoint between those two extremes, right?
On the one hand, spectacle action, fused with deep lore and side quests,
and just endless spelunking.
Exactly.
And it's like, what an interesting place to end up, because of course that's attractive to everyone publishing games at the moment, because you just have to take a look at the history of Skyrim's fucking very storied kind of publishing history. It's been re-released about 70 fucking times, so often that it's a meme that Bethesda themselves join in on. And it just keeps raking in cash. People rebuy it for every new platform that comes out. People haven't stopped playing it for over a decade. And by all accounts, it looks like they will continue to play it and mod it and discuss it and talk about it. And it still does, you know, like years later, it still does really well for us when Skyrim is still a massive traffic driver for games websites. Like, and what else is there to say about the fucking thing? It's just because people love it and it's always current because people are always playing it. So it's in some ways, it's not a surprise to see the fucking Skyrimification of everything.
Yeah. People can't get enough of that claw quest. Gotta play the golden claw quest every single time you start a new character.
To the point where there are like multiple mods that say like you can just skip Bleak Falls Barrow. God of War, just to swing it back around, I'm about to get stuck into it. I'm still finishing off 2018 because I take forever to finish games. But just on that point as well, Assassin's Creed Valhalla, talking about like, you know, Assassin's Creed Valhalla is a single player game that has seasons and all that live service stuff. And they've really tried to like, they've gone way too far the other way. I think God of War Ragnarok is a much nicer midway point between like the kind of the action spectacle game and the never ending game. It's just a nice, meaty, kind of slow release version of that that isn't going to take 400 hours to complete, but also is going to feel like, yeah, actually, this is worth 70 quid. And surely that's where you want it to be, right?
Yeah, I think I'm in the minority of people because I didn't really like despite having, I think, 100 hours of playtime in that game, I didn't really like Assassin's Creed Valhalla. I had to do a lot of it for
you know what? I don't like it either. I just feel fucking trapped by it.
It's too big.
Yeah,
I've described it to people as like the world's most padded video game.
It really is. God, it really is.
The God of War is so different in that, like I said earlier, that the structure of it is that you have a really tight, really interesting main story quest, and then it says, do you want to go and do some other stuff at the end of that? Assassin's Creed Valhalla stretches everything out. That's like you're halfway through a story beat, and then it's like, okay, your next mission's all the way across the map, so you have to schlep over there, through some kind of circuitous river, through a load of stuff through nothing for ages, and then when you get there, it'll be like, oh, Eivor, would you like to go fishing? And I'm just like, no, I want to know who the bad guy is, please.
Yeah. If it was a book, you'd just look at it and think, well, God, that desperately needs an editor.
Exactly. God of War Ragnarok contains a huge amount less walking slowly next to a character as they expose dialogue or whatever. when you're walking next to a character who's talking slowly like that, you're not fooling anybody that you're actually in control of it. I think they do it to try and not to have too many cutscenes that feel like you're not in control of the action or whatever. But God of War Ragnarok is not scared to have a little cutscene, and you enjoy every second of it.
I mean, that's a box quote, isn't it? Not afraid to have a little cutscene. No, I love it. And I think it's perhaps it is video games, the video game, but it's just a really good example of where things are, and absolutely dripping with merit on its own, and it looks incredible. And hopefully it's going to make $1 billion so we get another one.
Hopefully it didn't cost $1 billion to make as well.
There he is. There's the God of War. Consider your blood debt paid. Be seeing you.
Like and subscribe and all that, I mean, if you want, I'm not your mum. And check out the weekly VG 24/7 Best Games Ever podcast if you quite like listening to people mugging off their boss. I should probably stop doing that, actually.